Hello everybody and welcome to another Anime Thoughts and Opinions video. Disclaimers that used to be listed at the beginning of these videos are now listed at the top of the description down below. Those disclaimers can give you a clearer picture of the style of discussion video that I do for this series. So it is the afternoon on the 30th of March right now, 2023, and I'm deciding to sit down and do this video. I probably wasn't originally going to make this video today, but I don't know how things can shift in my mood day to day, and I don't know about tonight or tomorrow especially. So I've had a nap, a pity nap as I would call it, and I just got up recently and had a bite to eat, and I feel like I can sit down and do this video, and hopefully it'll go all right. I have some things to say in regards to today's episode, and well, I suppose that's everything. So we're going to be seeing a bug fly by in front of the monitor. Get out of here. Ooh, that's gross. That ooh is an indication that I got it. So in this episode, we're going to be talking about the anime 86. 86 twice because it's the number and then the letters. Okay, so 86, as I'll just be referring to it by for simplicity's sake here, is a show that I've known of its existence for a little while, and but it was only, I think it was a couple months ago, maybe even a few months ago, but I think it was more a couple months ago, I had the plan to sit down and actually watch it. I really wanted to see it. I had an interest had grown, and I'll explain exactly how I got an interest in it. And then I put it on the list of things to watch with Aki whenever we could get around to it. And, you know, we've been watching through JoJo's Bizarre Adventure, and in between each part of JoJo, we would sit down and watch a few other shows. And the one that I wanted to get through, obviously, was Made in Abyss. But now that we've gotten through that and we've gone through some other stuff, we were able to sit down and start 86. Now, I wasn't expecting Aki to have us start 86 so soon. I thought we would be doing this after JoJo Battle in Egypt. But we started the first season of 86 now, and we've just finished it up today, earlier today. And now I can sit and talk about it. Now, how I kind of decided I wanted to watch it, it's actually, let's just say, I'll say right up front that it is not at all what I was led to believe it would be. Now, that had nothing to do with my actual enjoyment of the show. I had just come into it because I had discovered on the internet a comparison that was made between the two shows that said, hey, if you like this show, you're going to absolutely love this one. And I was like, oh, okay, well, I'm looking for shows that are similar to what I've seen in the past, and 86 is apparently one of the higher rated ones, so I'll sit down and watch it. The show that I was looking for was Darling in the Franxx, and I was looking for shows that were similar to Darling in the Franxxx, and there was a list online, and 86 was at the top of the list of shows like Darling in the Franxxx. Total bullshit, it's nothing like Darling in the Franxxx, outside of maybe you have young people piloting machines. That's about the closest you will actually get to it being similar. Now, fair warning, I don't think this video is going to be all that long. Like, I honestly wouldn't be surprised if this ended up being 20 or 30 minutes long. It is a short show after all, but it's really because I don't feel like I have all that much to say about it, which is surprising considering the type of show that this is and just how interesting I think that the setting is. Now, my headline I gave on the Twitter post and the Discord post might make you believe that I did not like this show. That's not the case. In fact, there's nothing about 86 I didn't like. With maybe the small exception of the liquid metal hands that come out of one of the robot machine things later on, that's the only thing that I kind of was like, it got a little bit too anime when I was getting really immersed in the setting. But other than that, there's no issue I have with the show. It's not like, you know, it's not like, not to compare it to, not to compare it like narratively to the show Aldenoa Zero, which I saw a couple years ago. It's a similar experience for me in that that show had a lot of issues that I had with it. Like, there were things I just straight up did not like about it. But here, there is none of that case. The problem I'm worried about is if, like with Aldenoa Zero, after about 2 weeks, I'm worried I'm not going to remember shit about 86. The biggest problem I had wasn't that I didn't like it or didn't enjoy it even. It was just that I found it really hard to care by the end of the show. Now, it's only 11 episodes long, but so is Mushoku Tensei. And this show, the themes of 86 are way, way, way higher than anything Mushoku Tensei could dream of being. But I think I liked Mushoku Tensei more, which is weird. They're not the same show. They don't deal with the same thing, so you can't compare them one to one. But in terms of my enjoyment, how was I able to enjoy a show with genres that I usually like less than a show like 86 with tags, themes, and genres and stuff that I like a lot more often? Well, I'll do my best to try to explain that, but let's just say it had to do with me finding it difficult to really care about the characters by the end of the show. And again, it's not a case of like Iron-Blooded Orphans, where I was actually hating at least one of the characters, and then the rest might have had a difficult time me really caring about. I don't really remember what I thought about the extended cast in that show. Here it was, there's nobody that I don't like in the cast. I just didn't really have any kind of feelings for them. I didn't care about their stories, with the exception of maybe one, which is one of our lead characters that is named Lena in the show. She's the only one that I kind of find interesting, and I think the only reason I find her interesting is because of the dynamic between her and the 86 group. But I'll do my best to try to explain it. Now, I'm always a little bit worried when I talk about this kind of thing. I doubt 86 is going to get the same response that my Mushoku Tensei videos got, where those seem to be so fucking popular, that show, I mean, where my thoughts and opinions are getting hundreds of views in just the first couple days of being uploaded, which is so uncommon for my series. It takes like 2 years before you have 100 views on one of these videos, usually. But there is a popularity to 86, and it's a pretty highly rated show. Now, I guess what my memory was telling me is that 86 was like, you know, hundreds and 90s, but I guess it's more around the 80 range average, so still really highly rated though. But it's constantly getting its praises sung about it. Like, I guess I obviously have not read the light novel, but from what I can tell from like what people are saying on analysts and stuff, apparently it is an extremely well done adaptation. And in that regard, I mean, I can't vouch for that myself, but if that's the case, then that's great, because, you know, if you're basing something off of a source material and you're attempting to adapt it and then you butcher that adaptation, looking at you, Promised Neverland, you're bound to please more people when you actually do a good job at adapting it. However, I cheated a little bit, and I looked at two of the top reviews on Analyst, which is something I never do. I always say that I should never read other people's reviews or thoughts and stuff, at least until I have made my own thoughts and opinions, because I don't want any influence on my actual discussion. But I was curious, because the biggest issue I had, like I said, was caring about these characters, and especially the group, the 86 group. I just really didn't care about them by the end. And I'll explain why. Trust me, I'll do my best to explain why that is. But both of these reviews, maybe I'm just an idiot, because both of these reviews, just, they were all up and hunky-dory about how amazing the characters are. And one of them, I think, even said that it's the show that made them actually care about the secondary characters. And, you know, then they go off to talk about characters from 86. I'm thinking, when I say from 86, I'm talking about the group of characters that are out fighting. When they said that, I was scratching my head thinking, what the fuck? You mean getting to see a couple minutes of a character and then they're dead, and then maybe you see a scene of them in a flashback afterwards is that's really extensively better than what you get in the books? I'd hate to see what the books do then. Maybe you get a whole sentence of a character before they're written off the show. I don't know. But let's talk about... Let me first just kind of go over, because like in like my notes, guys, this show 86, 11 episodes again. Now, so was like 11 and 12 episodes, so was Made in Abyss season 1 and 2 separately, so was Mushoku Tensei season 1 and part 2, and both of those had like a ton of notes on my page. I mean, Made in Abyss had an entire page all filled up with a whole bunch of information and stuff. This, I don't even have like a quarter of a page of notes on this show. That is how little there really is to write down. I mean, there's a lot of stuff that you're introduced to, but I was never really lost on it. I wouldn't say it's complicated or really overly deep. I mean, I'm sure it's deep, but the show doesn't make it seem that way. You don't get to go into the depths of it. But other than that, there was really nothing else to write down. Most of the events are glossed over or even just skipped by in between episodes. So, you know, there's no real point in writing those down. Most of like the meat and bone of this comes in at the beginning of the show when you're introduced to this new setting. And then at the end of the show when you have the climactic battle. You know, those are the two most important parts of the show for me, from my point of view. But perhaps season one is just a setup for season two. But the only reason that I kind of put a pin in that statement is because this show will attempt to play off some really emotional scenes with like emotional music and our characters reacting really emotionally. And it's directed in a way where you are also supposed to feel with the characters. But like I said during while I was watching, there's a scene where Lena kind of has a bit of a mental breakdown, and she has that classic anime scream cry moment, which usually in anything will make me tear up and probably cry too, because it's a very impactful and powerful and emotional like statement that's being made on screen. But I remember vividly saying, "You haven't earned that, Lena." Because it just felt like they were trying too hard to have this emotional scene, but I didn't care about what was going on. I didn't care about the characters that were being affected or that they were talking about. Because I just feel like 86 does not give you any time at all to give a shit about the characters. You know, call it cold for me. I mean, obviously, not everyone agrees. I mean, I already can tell, but based off of the two reviews that you can see on Analyst that state that the secondary characters or the characters in general are the most interesting part of the show. But you call me cold, but I didn't care about Shin. I didn't care about his brother subplot. I didn't care about, I mean, you get introduced to his subplot about his brother and then it's kind of like finished up all in the span of like the same episode and a half or some shit where he ends up actually meeting his brother again and defeats him, brings peace to him, you know, so that he can have true freedom. You know, there is an interesting factor about the way that these characters work and operate with one another. That's interesting. But the actual characters themselves or their stories, I don't even remember half their names. Now, I've always had problems remembering names off the bat when watching anime sometimes, but I don't remember these guys' names. I mean, by the end of the show, there's five characters left out on the battlefield. I remember two of them. I remember Anju, I think her name is, and then Shin. I don't know what the other characters' names were. I'm sure if you told me their name, I'd be like, oh yeah, that person. But off the top of my head, I don't remember what the fuck their names are, you know? And I couldn't tell you if it's because the show moves too fast and does too little with the characters, or if it's just that I just don't find it interesting in the first place. It's one of those two, right? If it moves too fast, where I feel like I don't have enough time to actually, you know, build a relationship with characters, because you look at a show like Mushoku Tensei, again, which we just watched, that's also only 11 episodes, and characters started to grow on me over time. You know, in that show. So if the runtime isn't an issue, or I even thought about a movie, right, about a group of characters, a small group of characters that die off by the end of the movie, and that movie's only like 2 hours and something long, which is about half the runtime of this anime, and yet I feel like I was able to care more about the characters in that movie than I did in this show. So I'm not sure if it's just there's too many events moving by too quickly, because when I say they move by fast, I mean it. There'll be the group of 86, before I kind of summarize the story and talk about the stuff that I was really intrigued by, the cast of 86, like in Sector 86, there's a huge group of characters there, like a massive group. And then every other episode, like almost all of them get wiped out off screen. Or, for example, there will be a scene on screen where it'll last literally a few seconds where you see artillery like striking multiple juggernauts, and then then they're like, oh, we've lost pretty much the rest of our squad, you know, and then at the beginning of the next episode, and you're just like, wait, what? Who? We lost everyone? What the fuck's going on? And now, so I think what they're really wanting you to do is to care most about the five characters that are left by the end. But going in, you don't know who's going to survive at the end, so you don't know that these five characters are going to be the ones that survive. And hell, it's not like these five characters get the most screen time either. I mean, maybe they technically do, like out of a technicality, I don't know. But the thing is that these characters that are left alive at the end, with the exception of Shin, who does get the most screen time out of all of them, I didn't know Anju or the red-haired girl or that short blonde-haired guy. I didn't know they were going to be the ones left at the end, so I didn't know I was supposed to care about them. They get just about as much screen time as the other secondary characters that get written off right away. I'm not exaggerating when I say they will show you a character and then they will die in the same episode, and then you'll get like a flashback scene with them in the next episode, and then that's it. Maybe they'll refer back to them by name, you know, like the group of characters, like, oh man, I miss her, you know, and stuff like that. But it's like I'm supposed to care about her and her backstory, but I really don't. And I just don't really know if that's just because of a lack of interest in the characters, or if it's because the show moves too fast through these events that I just don't have time to give a shit, you know, about them. So the story about it, though, let's talk about that. First of all, I didn't even go over the formalities here. 86, okay? 86, Studio A1 Pictures have worked on this, who did have a hand in working on Darling in the Franxx, which might be why that also came up on that list. And it is a television anime that runs 11 episodes, 24 minutes per episode, and it released from April 11th, 2021 to June 20th, 2021. So it released while I was in Walmart hell. So I'll always remember that. And it is listed on Analyst as an action drama mecha sci-fi. So the story, from what I understand, is you have two warring countries. You have the Republic of San Magnolia, I think it's called. We'll just refer to it as the Republic. And then you have the, what the fuck is it called? It's called like the Gyadian Empire or something like that. I'm probably pronouncing that wrong. But we'll just refer to it as the Empire for simplicity's sake. Now, it is not difficult to compare a lot of the themes in this show to like World War II and stuff, whether that's intentional or not. I'll try to keep that discussion out, but there's a lot of, like, I don't know, like, for example, if the, you know, Aki and I, when we were watching it, we were trying to figure out, like, oh, is this supposed to be based off of Russia? Is this supposed to be based off of Germany? Is this supposed to be based off of, you know, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. But it's weird because it's almost like a mix of things. Like, for example, it's almost like a mixture of different countries that build, like, real-world countries that influence these fantasy countries here in 86. Like, for example, the Republic, they use a lot of German terminology. Even the way that the Juggernaut stats are listed is very like German military-esque. Yet the Juggernaut itself is like called the M401 or something like that. It's got a very American military designation to it. The Empire, which is on the Eastern Theater, which is like the Eastern Front, you really get led to believe like they are Russians. But then when they actually go into what's left of the Empire, you will actually see that it's very Japanese themed. So I don't really know where the real world influences came from, unless it's, like I said, a mixture of different countries. But either way, so you have these two warring countries, right? And you have the Republic, which is a who are fighting a war against the Empire of these drones and these machines. They're basically robots. And the Republic claims that their drones are unmanned, so there are no actual casualties in war. Total bullshit. Which is one of the interesting parts of the show. Like I'll be completely honest and say that everything that happens outside of the fighting and characters, I think, is more interesting than the actual characters themselves. I wish that we could have gotten more of the actual war setting, like the two countries and their history, rather than whoever the fuck Shin is and whatever his brother's relation is with him, you know? At least that's just how I felt about it. So, You've got the Republic, who claims that there's no casualties in war, but it turns out that their quote-unquote drones, which are juggernauts, are actually manned. And they are manned by people from Sector 86. Now, this country is basically a purist country. They are very racist. They subjugate people that have different hair color, different skin color, different eye color, everything. If you don't have silky, silvery hair and blue eyes, you get sent to Sector 86, to internment camps and all that kind of shit. So, okay, pretty mature setting we've got here. And it's these people that are forced to fight for the Republic out in the East, where the Empire's robots are coming from. Now, additionally, the Empire's bots are not manned. They are apparently autonomous drones, so they are properly drones. What's interesting, though, is you learn that the Empire that built these things, I think, actually collapsed, and I don't know if like their autonomous drones turned on them and wiped them out from within or something, and now it's the drones are fighting the Republic. I don't really remember what the reason was there, but you get these unmanned drones that are coming from a country that no longer has order. It no longer has its own, you know, chain of command. It's just a country of robots, basically. That's interesting. And apparently these autonomous drones have like 50,000 hours of lifetime, like of battery life, basically. So it's basically a war of attrition where they're fighting against these guys until they all just power down. But then you'll learn like there are certain new types of drone that don't have the same lifespan, and they can keep coming back. And it has to do with like how they harvest the pilots of the juggernauts, and they harvest the brains of the humans and then kind of assimilate them into an artificial intelligence, and so they become like commanders on the battlefield for the enemy, which is kind of weird but kind of interesting at the same time. And like if they manage to acquire a full brain, they're known as, nicknamed shepherds, I think. And then I think black sheep are the ones that they call the like half-brained ones, the ones that are like half collected. I don't really know too much about that. Like, I'm probably wrong on that, but either way, you do get to see, like, for example, Shin has this whole subplot about his brother and their past and how he's been looking for his brother for the past 5 years or whatever. And Shin's like kind of the head, or the unofficial head of the spearhead squadron of Sector 86, which is the squadron we focus on during the show. Anyways, Shin's brother ends up being one of these shepherds that they fight at one point. So that's going on. You have processors and handlers, and like handlers are these people, I guess, back in the capital city of the Republic, the Empire, in the Republic. And these handlers, I guess, they're kind of like strategists that sit down with a whole bunch of monitors, and they basically control the battlefield from the safety of their home. I don't really remember. I mean, you have Lena, who is the character in the Republic, who has been promoted to major, and she is assigned to be the next handler for the Spearhead Squadron. And because apparently they have a reputation of their handlers like committing suicide, you know, or deteriorating in their brains and stuff. And so she is assigned to them, and she's like really inexperienced, or just has a different expectation than what ends up happening. Now, you basically, for the entire show, you will see her be really useless, not because her character herself is useless, but just because her need isn't, there is no need for her on the battlefield. Basically, the group, the Spearhead Squad, is basically doing everything themselves. They don't need someone telling them what to do, because she's always one step too late. Like, there's a moment later where she attempts to warn them about artillery, but the artillery has already struck and killed one of them, or two of them, or something like that. Maybe even more than that. This puts a lot of like mental stress on her. She isn't like the rest of the Republic that looks down on these people. She sees them as humans, and she's even fighting against the system back in the city, you know, trying to get justice for these people. And you know, that's why I find Lena the most interesting character, because she's living in luxury right now, but while also still suffering from basically feeling responsible for everything that's happening to these people out on the battlefield. So And the thing that I wanted most out of her character was I was hoping she would leave the city and go out onto the battlefield as like an on-field commanding officer with the rest of the group. But that never happens. She does leave, but only at the very end of the show does she manage to go outside and go to like the camp or the base that our characters were stationed at. But by this point, the story has already progressed where nobody of the group is left, and the remaining five that had survived have set off into unknown territory and have lost connection, and so you don't know what happens to them. Well, I mean, we get to see, but I don't think Lena knows what happened to them. All the while, there is this thing called the Pararaid, which is like this... It's this thing. They use it like a Bluetooth device where they're talking to each other. You know, like they can communicate with each other. Lena can communicate with everyone in the base from anywhere. But the thing is like it apparently connects via sensory data. It shares sensory data between people, and so it's really dangerous. And that might have something to do with why people end up committing suicide. I guess because I don't know if it's like the overload of the emotional stress and PTSD that's going on. I'm not really sure why that happens, but they said that happens. So that's kind of the general gist of the story, right? It's and like, you know, the people in Sector 86, they were promised that they'd be allowed, you know, first class return to the Republic once they've done their duty, but in reality, they're never coming back. They were never meant to come back. They're meant to be fodder for the Republic. Once they're killed off, then they're just replaced with new people. They're meant to be killed off. There is no justice for these people, which is fucked up. Again, the world setting, I still think, is way more interesting than any of the characters. I wish we could have spent more time on that. That's the gist of the entire story there. Now, by the end of the show, like, you have the events throughout, but by the end of the show, you have five characters left of the main squad that we started with. And of these five characters, you have Shin, who has kind of grown a bit closer to Lena and vice versa by the end, since they're always talking with one another. And they set off into unknown territory where the Pararaid disconnects, you know, they don't have connection anymore, and they're setting off on a suicide mission, basically. And they set off with five juggernauts, which are their vehicle, their mech, basically, which I'll talk more about the design of this thing in just a moment. They set off with five of those, and then, like, they lose four of the five. And unfortunately, you only get to see that in, like, a scene where you get to see them, like, outside of their juggernauts shooting assault rifles and stuff. But you don't actually get to see the full battle that took place, which really sucked. I don't know why they pushed over that. And then so it comes to a point where, you know, they're out and they're exploring, and this is where you learn that the Empire really, I guess, has collapsed, because there's like overgrowth for the past 9 years. You have these abandoned towns and cities that have been overgrown with shit. Originally, I had thought that the Republic saying that the Empire collapsed within, I thought that was just a lie, because they're already covering up stuff about Sector 86. Maybe they're lying about the Empire as well. Maybe there is, you know, maybe there actually is an Empire there, and they're just using this as a guise to wage war. I don't know. But I guess it really did collapse, and these characters are exploring, and then, you know, you come to the final climactic battle where, like, Shin uses the last juggernaut to go and basically throw himself into the abyss. And then the other four go charging out, and the ending is kind of left a bit ambiguous. Like, it's obviously teasing you for the next season, where Lena comes out to the base that they used to all be at, and, you know, she's got this big, huge look of determination on her face, as if she's going to, you know, she's going to head out and look for them, or at least she's going to take command of a new unit to find them or something. Like, she's got this look of determination, like she has toughened up, basically. Meanwhile, you've got Shin, who you don't see die on screen. He gets overwhelmed and defeated, but you don't actually see him commit suicide, nor do you see him get brain stabbed on screen. So presumably he will return in the next season, and I don't know if he'll return as an AI, as in his brain was sucked, or if he will just be a returning character in general. And the other four characters that were with him, they all are, like, shown to be dead, in quotations. They're, like, all face down on the ground, but you don't see, like, any big bullet holes or tears in their clothing or anything. It doesn't look like they're really dead. It looks like maybe they were just knocked out. But then again, I don't, what, did one of the fucking robots come up to them and punch them in the face? I doubt that, you know, so I don't know about them either. I feel like they would probably are also dead, or may also not be dead, I guess I should say. But for the, at the very least, Shin is the only one who has their fate that is completely unanswered, like not even with a little hint as to what happened, what might have happened, but not what did happen. So, again, like I said, I don't mean to keep bringing this up, but I didn't really care by the end. Like, once we had finished, I had felt, like, kind of empty. And not that emptiness you get in your, you know, this pit in your stomach where you're like, oh, man, that was so amazing. Or oh, man, I'm so depressed now after all that, there's this pit that I have to wait, this void that needs to fill back in after a while. I never felt that. I felt this emptiness of, the show's over? What the fuck? Like, am I... What did I miss? You know, like that's kind of the feeling I had. That was the reaction I had. Well, that, and I was crying too, but that's besides the point. But that was kind of the reaction that I had by the end in my head. And I think I was even saying that to Aki before we had finished the show. I think we were on like episode 7, 8 or maybe 9. And I said like, I think I said in word for word, I think I said like, the anime is interesting, but I'm finding it really hard to care. That I think that's exactly what I said. And I still feel like even after finishing the show that is exactly it. I find this show interesting. I just don't care. I just don't know. I just don't have this care for the story, the characters' stories, I guess. You know, maybe the world story I care about, but not the character stories. Maybe season 2 would change that. I guess I'd have to wait and see, but at least as far as an opening show. And like I said before, how they do all this emotional stuff, you know, like where Lena breaks down because the characters are heading off on a suicide mission and she can't stop them, you know, or the scene where our five characters leave their base, this base that they've been at for who knows how many years now. And they have this really like kind of emotional and touching scene where it shows all the different rooms of the base and kind of shows you flashbacks of all the characters doing things. There's a character named Fido, in quotations, character, who's like a robot who had recorded all of the, basically ever since it had showed up at the base after Shin had found it like on a battlefield somewhere, and it's been recording after all these years. And so you get to see all these flashes on screen of all the different things it went through, and it's supposed to be this really touching scene of like the characters are leaving their base, you know, and we're remembering all the characters that were lost, and it's really sad because they're leaving this place that they've come to call home, you know. And I'm like, the fuck, you mean the place we saw for like 5 minutes of screen time? You mean all those characters we saw for maybe a minute each? You know, obviously might be a bit of an exaggeration to say 5 minutes, but that's how I felt. I didn't feel any emotional impact from this. The show was making it seem like I was supposed to, but I just didn't feel that. And another thing that the show did very well, because of how quickly it kills everyone off, which again, I should actually mention something about that. But because of this, it was very easy to know who was going to die next. Maybe it's just because I've watched too many of these types of shows, because it's this type of thing is very common in storytelling. But you have the classic, suddenly one of the side characters is getting a little bit more screen time and they keep repeating their name over and over again, they must be the next one to die. And multiple times, that's exactly what happened. I even said, oh, so Fido is going to end up getting destroyed because now we are seeing his entire life through this camera lens, you know? And sure enough, once you go through like the fucking, I don't know, 6+ minutes worth of footage of back, you know, of flashback footage where you get to see all these characters over the years. It cuts to Fido being all broken down on the battlefield and then exploding at the end. That's exactly right. And maybe that's the point. Like, maybe somebody will tell me that's the point, is that, you know, this is war and you're not supposed to care about the characters. You're supposed to see the horrors of them getting killed off just so easily, like fodder and stuff. And it's more about the struggles of having to deal with that. And I guess that's okay. I guess I don't mind that. I guess I can accept that. But the issue that I have with it is that the show definitely tries to make you care. It wouldn't have these emotional scenes if you weren't meant to care for these characters. That it would be pointless. If you're just supposed to show me the fodder and make them kill off, maybe you can have emotional scenes with the other characters, but you don't have to do it for the viewer, you know, the characters that actually knew these people. But you don't have to do it for the viewer, but they were doing it for the viewer as well. So I feel like I was meant to be more invested in the 86 or the spearhead group. I'm not sure. I don't know more about like the world. Like, this is the only squad we focus on. I don't know. Is there other squads out there fighting? Excuse me. What about other countries around the world? What's going on with all them? You know, I want to know more about that kind of shit. But whatever. I don't know. It doesn't matter really. So I want to briefly talk about the juggernauts that they use, because Mecha has always been a point of contention on my opinions, my thoughts and opinions. Well, this is a mechanized vehicle. That's what I would call the juggernauts. It is not what I would consider Mecha in the traditional sense, which thank Christ for that. I've always had a hit or miss relationship with that type of thing. And you'll notice time and time again that most Mecha that I have seen that I actually really like, it chances are either the Mecha is not a central point of the show, like say with Darling and the Franks, or you have a show like Bokurano, which is a Mecha, but it is not traditional mech. It's a completely different type of beast, basically, right? You know, or something like Evangelion, where it's not even really a mech. In here, you've got the Juggernaut, which is a four-legged tank, basically, right? It's low to the ground, but it's really fast and maneuverable, and it's got a big old gun on it. It's actually really cool designed. I like the four legs. I thought it had six legs originally, but it actually only has four. It's got a big gun on it. Now, not that anyone else cares about this, but apparently the show and the wiki says that this thing has a 57 millimeter smoothbore gun. Bull fucking shit. That thing is way too big to be a 57 caliber. That's ridiculous. But that's something that only someone like me would care about, so whatever. If the show says it's 57 millimeter, I guess it's 57 millimeter. But the show also fires APFSDS that explodes. So I don't think it really fully understands what it's actually trying to show off and talk about. Again, something only somebody that knows about it would care enough about to complain, but whatever. Either way, it's got a big old gun on it that's cartridge fed, so it gets reloaded by like Fido, who's like a reloading bot or whatever. But it's also got two big blades for close quarter melee combat, for knife fighting basically, and then it also has two 50 caliber machine guns that is built into the structure, the hull of it. So it's got weapons and it's cool looking. It doesn't have a turret. It aims by maneuvering its legs so it can maneuver its body, unlike the autonomous drones that they're fighting, which do have turrets. A lot of them have actual turrets that are much more tank-like, and they have like the silvery purple glow to them. So overall, I liked the Juggernaut's design. I liked the guns. The big gun is a bit silly to see that huge ass cartridge in the back, but what made it really enjoyable is, aside from characters and story, is the visuals. It has pretty damn good looking CGI. The CGI explosions were awesome. The speed in combat, like these are mechs, right? They're machines, but they move really fast and maneuver around a bunch. So there, it's a very high pace, fast, action packed fighting scenes when you get them. You don't get a whole lot of them, and unfortunately, most of them get skipped over really fast. But when you do get them, they're really great. The soundtrack is pretty good too. I noticed right away that Hiroyuki Sawano had a role to play, because he has a very specific style. I don't know if he did compose the entire soundtrack or at least had a role in it, but I picked him out immediately. I was like, oh my god, this is Sawano's work, because he just has a style. You just know. And he is my favorite composer in this field of entertainment. So time and time again, every show that he has ever led or had a part in playing for its soundtrack is always like through the fucking roof in terms of its soundtrack for me. Shows that I even kind of dislike, I love for the soundtrack alone if he worked on them, a la Kill la Kill. So, but yeah, so soundtrack was good, the visuals were great, the CGI was pretty damn good looking. There's always post-credit scenes basically where the episode continues afterwards. So we did manage to watch those, so we weren't missing any extra context that we weren't already missing. And really, I guess that's... I kind of feel like that's it. I kind of feel like there's nothing else to really talk about. I mean, there's more stuff like with the characters of 86 where they, you know, like they shoot each other in the head after battle because, like, if they've been wounded, like fatally wounded or whatever. I guess the whole reason why Shin executes everyone, I mean, his name is the Undertaker after all, his like code name, his personal name or whatever. But I guess the reason that they do this is because so that their brains aren't scooped out by the robots and then used against them. But yeah, so overall, like, I hate doing this type of video right now because, like, even though I'm not in a bad mood, I'm in a bad mood. I'm not in the pissed off mood that I was in the Mushoku Tensei Part 2 video. It just sucks to have to do this right after the Mushoku video because I talked about, I had issues with that show and then I come into this one and I sound like I hate it when I don't. Like, I try to make it really clear, like, I don't hate the show I'm talking about. I would tell you if I did. I just, in this case, it's not even a case of disliking anything. Like I said, and I'll say one last time because I've repeated myself a lot, it was just a problem I had with caring about the characters or their stories. That was the issue I had. Not that I didn't like the characters or the stories. It's just that I did not find any investment in it. I didn't find any interest to be invested in it. Or I didn't find enough time to be invested in it, you know? And maybe season two will change that. If these characters continue, like if Lena or Shin, you know, survives, or the other group, the other four that are with Shin at the end, maybe if they continue to go on at the very end of the show, or excuse me, at the very beginning, or in the next season, I guess is what I meant to say, then maybe I'll be able to grow on them more and I'll actually start giving a shit about what happens to these characters or about their past. Like, the whole Shin and his brother thing, it's just way too rushed, in my opinion. It's brought up and then it's concluded right away. I feel like maybe if that was built up at the beginning of the show and then kind of was mentioned throughout, and then maybe at the end or the next season even, the whole confrontation with his brother comes up. If that were the case, maybe I would be more invested in that subplot, but I just wasn't in the first place. And plus, because I didn't even care about Shin when the subplot came around. Just like, oh, he's the typical, you know, I am the leader guy or the unofficial leader that's had to put up with so much bullshit in this war that I'm kind of emotionally dead. Though you do see him have emotion. You do actually see him break down after he puts his brother to rest, so to speak. So at least he is human. At least he is not the character we get in Iron-Blooded Orphans. I can say Shin is probably 100% better than the protagonist you get in that show. But yeah, so I think that'll have to bring this one to an end. I managed to boot this video all the way up to 40 minutes, post 40 minutes even. I was thinking it would be like 20 minutes, like the Vinland Saga video, but that was more because I had waited so long to do that video that it was actually hard to make a thoughts and opinions, but someday I might have to remake that. But yeah, so in the end, for people that listen through, like, and I do have to say that I appreciate, like, in the Mushoku video, despite being in such a bad mood and basically bitching right off the start of that video, a lot of people still listened to it. A lot of people still were posting comments about stuff I was talking about later in the video. So for people that do say, even if, like, you're a huge 86 fan and it hurts for you to hear somebody say that they were just kind of disappointed with the overall experience they had, I still appreciate you sitting and listening through it, you know. And of course, feel free to post your own opinions on it down in the comments below. We can discuss it. That's one of the most fun parts, like I said, in my Mushoku video. It has a lot of traffic on that video, a lot of people posting comments, a lot of people talking about it, you know. And there's a lot of things, points and stuff people bring up, and a lot of agreements or disagreements and stuff, you know. And as long as it stays civil, I think it's a fun and part, an enjoyable part of doing the thoughts and opinions series. But again, just remember, however I made it sound, I did not dislike this show. I have a lot of interest in its world and setting. I just feel like I needed more time with the characters in the end. I think that's all I needed, right? But Lena was the only one I found interesting, mainly because she has this, she's kind of like being torn between these two different worlds, basically, right? And she's kind of trying to fight for both almost, but she's definitely seeing just how shit the Republic has been treating these people. But yeah, so we'll see where season two goes. I don't know what we're watching next. Unfortunately, Aki and I's night ended pretty rough, so we didn't talk about what we were going to be watching next. I don't know if we're going to JoJo Battle in Egypt next, which I would assume, I thought we were going to be having done that already, but I'm not sure if that's what's coming up or if we're going to go straight to 86 season two, because I will be watching 86 season two. I'm not going to put it off. I'm going to end up sitting down and getting to it and finishing it. But as for other stuff that I'll be watching soon, I'm in the process of watching Dr. Stone Stone Wars right now, which I did not realize that I saw Dr. Stone 3 years ago now, almost 3 years ago now. But that I'm watching with somebody, and that'll be an upcoming episode. I don't know if it'll be the next episode or one of the next episodes. And also I'm sitting down to rewatch Made in Abyss soon, because of course I am. It's been a long time since I saw that. And by a long time, I mean like a couple weeks, and not even a couple weeks for Made in Abyss season two. But yeah, so feel free to post your own comments and thoughts in the comment section down below, and you can always suggest new anime, manga, visual novels, etc. to me. They get added to the respective lists, and well, that's gonna bring this one to an end. Thanks for watching, guys, and I'll see you in the next Anime Thoughts and Opinions video. Goodbye.